Have you ever wondered why Jesus didn't bring peace to the world? And in fact, why he would say, "Do you think I've come to bring peace?" No, but rather division. Well, we're going to be looking at that in today's broadcast. You stay tuned. God, thank you for the broadcast today. I pray that the Word of God might go out with freedom and clarity. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Lord Jesus has just given the greatest sermon the world has ever heard. Huge multitudes of people heard it. It's called the Sermon on the Mount. Now he's finished with the sermon and he's coming down off the mountain, and the people are making comment about what they had just heard. Look what they say in Chapter 7, verse 28. "And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes." The people were absolutely astounded. They'd never heard a message like this before in their life. They had gone to the scribes and the lawyers' Bible studies, and they always quoted their favorite rabbis. But Jesus, he went right to the Word of God and taught the Word of God with authority and with power, and they'd never heard a sermon like this before in their lives. Astounded. Well, I can imagine this would have caused a big stir in the nation of Israel. A lot of the folks that attended this Bible study no doubt went back home and started talking to their parents about what they had just heard. I can hear the conversation going along something like this, these lines. "Dad, I just heard the most wonderful sermon I've ever heard in my life." And the dad would say, "Well, who was it, son? Was it Gamaliel or possibly Rashid or maybe Shomel? Who was it that was teaching you?" "Well, it was Jesus." "Jesus? Jesus who?" "Well, Jesus of Nazareth, the prophet from Nazareth." "Well, I don't know about him. I think that the people that I hang out with say that he's a false prophet." "No, Pa, no, no, no. He gave a most wonderful sermon. And Dad, he said such wonderful things. I'd never heard things like this. Dad, he told us that we can have the power to actually love our enemies. And he has told us that the Pharisees and the legalists of Israel are leading people down the wrong path, and they're kind of like actors, and they're putting on a big play, and they're misleading people." And the father would probably say at this juncture, "Well, hold it, son. I happen to be a Pharisee. What are you talking about? What else did this Jesus say?" "Well, Dad, Jesus said that the false teachers are like spiritual policemen, and they're pointing people to a broad road that he says leads to destruction. And Dad, the way that leads to life is very narrow, and the gate is very narrow, and to go to heaven, it's a narrow road. And Dad, he says he is the door. And if any man enters by him, he shall be saved. And all the other Bible teachers are pointing the wrong way. Is he calling me a false teacher?" I can hear it right now. "Dad, you have to hear Jesus. I believe he's the Messiah of Israel." "And Dad, he says that the reason that these folks are teaching the wrong thing, because they're teaching that the law saves people. And by the way, that's exactly what they taught, and that's what they're teaching to this very day. If you keep the law, particularly the Sabbath, and you have enough mitzvahs, good works, that surely God will let you into heaven. The Bible says there's the way that seems right to a man, but that way ends in death." "But Dad, Jesus says that salvation isn't found in the law, but it's found in the atonement, the blood sacrifice. Did not Moses say, 'Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin'? Dad, it's the blood sacrifice that saves us, the payment for sin, not the law." "Son, if you keep this talk up any further in this house, you're no longer going to be called my son." The Lord Jesus said, "Do you think I've come to bring peace on the earth? No, but rather division." From now on, a man's enemies be members of his own household. Father against son, daughter against mother, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. This is the message that the Lord Jesus brought to the world. It brought division to Israel, and it brings division to the world today, does it not? Lord Jesus taught with authority, and he taught that Moses, with his authority, would tell of a prophet who was going to come that would speak with the same kind of authority. And did not Jesus say in the Sermon on the Mount, you have heard that it's been said? Moses said that. But I say unto you, love your enemies. You have heard to hate your enemies. I'm telling you to love them. Jesus spoke with the same authority of Moses because he is greater than Moses, and he's exactly the prophet that Moses said would come. Moses said, there's going to come one after me, just like me. And if you don't hear that prophet, you're going to be cut off. Serious warning. The Lord Jesus has given his inaugural speech to the nation of Israel. The way a president, when he comes to office, gives an inaugural speech, the Sermon on the Mount is his inaugural speech. He's laying down the lines. He's telling it like it is. And the people, they were astonished. They loved that kind of a Bible study. Now, if you're making claims like Jesus made, brother, you'd better be able to back them up. Now the Lord Jesus, we discover in the 8th chapter and the rest of the Gospel of Matthew, is going to present his credentials to the nation of Israel, and most notably to the Sanhedrin. He's saying he is the Messiah. Better be able to prove it, because the prophet said that the Messiah would perform miracles, that lame people would be healed, that deaf people would hear, and blind people would see. He would be a miracle-working Messiah and have the power of God to prove exactly who he was. That's what he does. Chapter 8, verse 1, I'm reading. When he had come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and worshipped him, saying, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. Then Jesus put out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing. Be cleansed. Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. Now this is a remarkable story for a number of reasons. Leprosy was the worst disease any man could catch. If you got cancer, you had a hope of being cured of it. And all other diseases, there's usually some kind of hope, but not leprosy. It was a fatal disease. Fatal. A long, slow process of dying where your body would literally fall apart, fall off. It's called Hansen's disease today. It was a horrible disease. Not only was it an absolute death sentence, but it was even worse than that. Nothing worse could happen to anybody. You were removed from society, removed from your children and your wife. You couldn't live under the roof that you were the household of. You were sent out into the wilderness to a leper colony to beg for food at best and die a long, slow, painful death. Your fingers would fall off. You'd lose feeling in your hands and your feet, your extremities. A rat could come along and eat your toe off in the middle of the night, and you wouldn't even know it because you wouldn't feel it. They walked around Israel, and they'd say, unclean, unclean, ostracized, banished from society, outcast under anybody's conditions. And now we see a leper who's coming to Jesus. And by the way, you can imagine the leper colonies. The word went out, we believe the Messiah is coming. It's like Franklin Roosevelt said in the Depression years in the 30s in America. He said to the people, when you get to the end of your rope, and of course they were going through great trials of poverty. It was awful. The work was something like 30% of the folks were unemployed. When you get to the end of your rope, Franklin Roosevelt said, tie a knot and hang on. The only hope that the lepers had in Israel was that someday, and they hoped very soon, a Messiah would come and heal them. Otherwise, they had no other hope at all. And now the word has gone out that this wonderful man has been preaching a wonderful sermon and doing miracles. And the word is spreading among the colonies, the leper colonies. There's hope. The Messiah has come. The Messiah has come. Now we see this man running up to Jesus, and he doesn't even cry out, unclean, unclean. He probably had rags all wrapped around him, and he was an obvious leper. I can imagine that when the crowd saw this guy running towards Jesus, they scattered. They didn't want to touch him. You could catch the disease. And there he is, falling down in front of the Lord Jesus, the only hope he had, the only hope he had. And he said, Jesus, Lord Jesus, he called him. I love that. Lord Jesus, if you are willing, you can cleanse me. He knew it. And Jesus said, I am willing. And he reached out and did something astounding. He touched him. You don't touch lepers unless you're God in the flesh. If a man touches another leper, he'll catch leprosy. But if God touches a leper, Jesus touches a leper, the leper gets healed. And that's exactly what Jesus did. He reached out and he touched the man, and the man was absolutely healed. How wonderful! Hope! Hope has come to Israel, to a class of people that knew they needed help, desperate help. They had a fatal disease. And now the Messiah has come. Now look what happens. Verse 4. And Jesus said to him, see that you tell no one, but go your way and show yourself to the priest, and offer the gift that Moses commanded as a testimony to them. Number one, I have healed you, wonderful. But listen, don't go broadcasting that too much, because you see, the nation Israel is looking for a political Messiah, somebody to cast out Rome, and I didn't come for that reason. Not one word of politics in the Sermon on the Mount. But there sure is lots of discussion about the way God wants people to be and the way to have eternal life. And Jesus didn't want to foment trouble before his ministry was up. He had approximately 3 years to go. So don't spread it abroad. But I do want you to do one thing. I want you to go on down to the priest. And if you can find the same priest that said that you were a leper and put that stamp on you, you go to that guy and offer a gift for your cleansing. I want you to do that as a testimony to them. Well, this is remarkable because there was no cure for leprosy. None. And although there was a provision in the Mosaic law found in Leviticus, the 14th chapter, for examining a man who had been cured, it had never been used for 1,500 years because nobody had ever been cured of leprosy. And the only man that was cured in Israel happened to be the Naaman, the Syrian general. So he didn't obviously go down to the temple. But now the priest all of his life had been examining people with leprosy. If they had a little white, bright spot on their skin, he would designate that person as a leper. He was removed from society, but none of them ever came back. None of them came back healed. But now this man shows up on the priest's doorstep, so to speak. Now, this is remarkable. And I have no doubt the first time this guy showed up at Jerusalem and maybe a letter was sent in, maybe he was at the Mount of Olives, number one, he would never go into the city of Jerusalem. That wasn't allowed. But he would be outside the city, and the priest would go out and examine him. And he'd send a little note. Tell the priest, so-and-so, who you designated as a leper 10 years ago, is back. And he is very anxious to be examined by you and declared to be clean. Because I got a wife and family waiting for me in a home, and I want to go home, and Jesus healed me, so come on out and examine me. Well, the priest would probably say, impossible. Nobody's been cleansed of leprosy. And maybe his attendant would say, well, you know what, Mr. Priest, this guy's name is on the records, and you did, after all, say that he was a leper to start off with, and it's the same man. I think you really ought to go out and examine him and find out what's cooking. Well, let's see what's cooking. Turn over to the book of Leviticus with me, to the 14th chapter. Yep, 14th chapter of Leviticus. Here are the rules and regulations concerning the cleansing of a leper. Very significant. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, verse 1, chapter 14, saying, "This shall be the law of the leper for the day of his cleansing. He shall be brought to the priest, and the priest shall go outside of the camp, and the priest shall examine him. And if indeed the leprosy is healed of the leper, then the priest shall command to take from him who is to be cleansed two living and two clean birds." See the picture now. Two birds, a couple of pigeons. You can imagine it ain't going to be a lamb or a goat or a bullock, because this guy is dirt poor. He's a leper. But he can afford a couple of pigeons. Anybody could afford a couple of pigeons in Israel. That's just a couple of little copper coins would take care of that. And so God's making provision for the leper. "Bring a couple of birds to me," the priest says. And he went out and looked at him and says, "Are you sure you're the same guy that was here 10 years ago?" "Yep, it's me." "And how in the world is it, my whole ministry, you're the first one that ever showed up healed?" "I found the Messiah. I found Jesus." By the way, this priest is going to be mighty busy the next 3 years, because thousands, no doubt, of lepers are going to flow into Jerusalem to seek his examination to declare them to be clean. I would suppose there wasn't a leper in the nation of Israel by the time Jesus was done. It's too bad the Pharisees wouldn't go to him and be cleansed of their spiritual leprosy. But no, too proud for that. But brother, when you got a death sentence, you are desperate. You'll do anything. And they did. They ran to Jesus in their desperation, and they were healed. And now the priest says, "Okay, bring a couple of birds. Here's what we're going to do." Now look at this, I think, wonderful picture of atonement. Listen to this now. And I'm reading in verse 4. "Then the priest shall command to take from him, for him, who is to be cleansed, two living and two clean birds. Cedar wood, scarlet, and hyssop." And there's great spiritual significance here. It's this. Every sacrifice in the Old Testament, bar none, points ahead to the cross of the Lord Jesus, where the Lamb of God is going to take away the sin of the world. These two little pigeons speak of the Lord Jesus dying on the cross, shedding his blood for the cleansing of sin. And now we notice there's other little articles in this cleansing process. The priest wouldn't have a clue what it was about, and probably the leper wouldn't either, but we should. Take cedar wood. Cedar wood is a red wood. Redwood trees, cedar. That cross was stained with the Messiah's blood. When they took him down, there was a cross. There was wood involved. And what else? And scarlet. And hyssop. Hyssop was a branch that they used to apply the blood over the doorposts at Passover. And scarlet wool, always as part of the sacrificial atonement, was a piece of wool that was dyed in a scarlet color that they got from grinding up these earthworms. It gave off a red color to it, and they dyed the wool in it. The Lord Jesus, when he died on the cross, said, "I am crushed like a worm." He bled on that cross, and that scarlet wool spoke of the sins of the world, the sins of Israel, the sins of the Gentiles. The prophet Isaiah said, "Although your sins are as scarlet, they shall become white as wool." White as wool. On the great day of atonement, they brought out the scarlet piece of wool, and when the atonement was accepted by God, the scarlet turned pure white. God performed a wonderful miracle for the nation of Israel. And every time they were pleasing to him and the sacrifice, the atonement was accepted, God put his stamp of approval on the blood sacrifice by performing a miracle. The scarlet wool turned pure white. Of course, that all ended in 33 AD, according to Josephus, the historian. It never happened again in the nation of Israel's history, because Jesus made one final last atonement for sin. And anything after that, and they did until 70 AD, meant nothing. The scarlet wool stayed scarlet because their sins were unforgiven. Heavy stuff. So, two pigeons, a piece of red wood, scarlet wool, and hyssop. And look what happens. And the priest shall command that one of the birds should be killed in an earthenware vessel over running water. As for the living bird, he shall take it in the cedar wood and the scarlet and the hyssop and dip them in the living bird and the living bird in the blood of the bird that was killed over the running water. And he shall sprinkle it seven times on him who is to be cleansed from the leprosy and shall pronounce him clean. And he shall let the living bird loose in the open field. What a wonderful picture of freedom. The one bird dies, and his blood is sprinkled not only on the leper to pronounce him clean, but on the wood, on the scarlet wool, and on the living bird. The living bird had blood sprinkled on him, but then the priest says he hadn't got the slightest idea what all this meant. He couldn't have. Took the bird out in the field and said, "You're free, go free." And that leper walked away, and you can imagine his family crying off in the distance, waiting for him. They couldn't get near him, but for 10 long years they hadn't been able to hug their dad and their husband. And there the family was, standing there weeping, watching this ceremony and looking at the blood being sprinkled on their dad. And then another bird taken out in the field, and it's got blood on it too, and it's free. That blood-stained bird symbolized the free leper. He was free, free from the bondage of his leprosy, and free from the bondage of being separated from his family, reconciled at last to his family by the blood. What a picture, what a picture. Well, leprosy in the Bible is a picture of something we don't like to talk too much about. It's called sin. Not a disease, sin. God says to the nation Israel, Isaiah, the third chapter, "My people, from their feet to their crown of their head are putrefying sores. They're bruised all over, running sores." They're a picture of leprosy. Spiritually, their sinfulness and their depravity look like leprosy to God. Oh, they look like outstanding people if you looked at them with your eyes. Oh, but God says you look like lepers. You need to be cleansed. Sin is an awful thing. It separates people, destroys families. It isolates people, just like the leper was isolated. Destroys families. Alcoholism, drug abuse, adultery. How many families have been broken up? How many people have been hurt by the leprosy of sin? Jesus, the Messiah, can reach out and touch you and heal you and restore your family. How wonderful this is. How wonderful. What a picture. Let's go on back to the 8th chapter of Matthew. Let's see what else we can learn. And by the way, it says, you notice, as a testimony to them, the priests, sure, they hadn't used this law for 1,500 years, but now all these lepers are coming to Jerusalem to be pronounced clean. And you know what happened in the book of Acts? In the book of Acts, when the gospel started going out, and Peter and John, the other apostles, started preaching to the priests, they said, the Messiah is going to cleanse people from their sin just the way he cleansed them from leprosy. And they would say, whoa, now you got that right. For 1,500 years, nobody's showing up. Now they're showing up in droves, and we're the ones that pronounce them clean. Jesus is the Messiah. And the Bible says that multitudes of the priests were turning to Jesus as Savior. What a testimony. They put the dots together. Let's put it that way. Now the Messiah is producing his credentials to the nation Israel. By the way, anybody that says they are a Messiah today, let them heal somebody of leprosy. Then we'll be convinced. Not going to happen, folks. It's incurable. The same way that sin is incurable, except through the blood of the Lord Jesus. Now look what happens. Verse 5. Now when Jesus entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." And Jesus said to him, Well, I will come and heal him. Now, Jesus has come back to his hometown, basically. He used Capernaum now as a base of operation. And a centurion comes running out to him. Centurion, a very important man. He's an officer in the Roman army, over 100 soldiers. Lord, I got a servant at home. He is paralyzed. He's going to die. He is in dreadful pain. Could you do something for him? And Jesus said, sure, I'll come on down and heal him. Of course. What else? The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come under my roof. But only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes. And to another, come, and he comes. And to my servant, do this, and he does it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed him, assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, as you have believed, so let it be done for you. Now, this centurion had a grasp of something that most people in the world today do not have a grasp on. And that's why Jesus marveled. He was astounded. This guy isn't a student of the scriptures, but he has grabbed a hold of a very important concept. The centurion said, you know what? I have authority. Comes ultimately from not just my generals, all the way up the line to Caesar himself. My authority comes from Caesar, and therefore I can order other people in Caesar's name to do this and do that and the other thing. And Jesus, you also have authority. Maybe he was there at the Jordan River when Jesus was baptized. And if he wasn't, he surely heard about it. This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased, God the Father said, a voice from heaven, supernatural. Sadducees went crazy over this because they didn't believe in anything supernatural. They said, oh, it was thunder. But God the Father said, no, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Jesus, you have the authority of the Father. I'm not worthy for you to come under my roof. That would be kind of an embarrassment for a Orthodox Jew to go into a Gentile's home. Just give the word. You have authority to send someone down to heal my servant. That someone was God, the Holy Spirit. This centurion had at least a rudimentary grasp of the Trinity. And the world has no concept of this for the most part. There's God the Father, there's God the Son, and there is God the Holy Spirit. And yes, Jesus can heal at a distance, and he did. Go your way, your servant lives. He went on down, and his servant was 100% astounding. Jesus marvels at the faith of the centurion. Be it according to your faith. This centurion, this Gentile, this dog, as the Jewish people would call them, had something they didn't have. The missing ingredient. They were trusting in their mitzvahs to get them to heaven. Going down the broad way. Spiritual policemen pointing people to the wrong gate. But here's a Gentile that had heard about Jesus' miracles, maybe heard the voice of God, and faith stirred in his heart. This is not some ordinary man. Maybe he'd even heard the Sermon on the Mount. You'd have to be a very foolish person to hear the Sermon on the Mount and think that Jesus was anything other than what he said that he was, the Messiah of Israel. Lord, you have authority. You healed my servant. I believe. He believed, and so it was according to his belief. And there you go. Salvation is by faith and faith alone. The narrow road is the road of faith. Jesus said, I am the door. I am the gate. If anybody enters by me, he shall be saved. We enter that gate by faith. This Roman soldier entered the gate of salvation by faith. And then Jesus makes this most remarkable prophetic statement. And I'm reading from verse 10. Assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith, not even in Israel. But I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of God. Stop right there. When's that going to happen? God has promised a great wedding feast for his own. Jesus came to call out a bride for himself, a church. And that church is on this earth, and the bridegroom is in heaven, but someday the bridegroom's going to come back, and the Bible says we should be caught up and meet the Lord in the air, and forevermore we're going to be with him. 7 long years. It'll be long for the people on the earth. The world will undergo what the Bible calls the great tribulation period. It's a day of Jacob's trouble. It's designed to bring the Jewish people back to faith in the Messiah. And at the end of that tribulation period, the heavens will part. The Son of God will come back with his church to this earth. And the Bible says his feet shall touch upon the Mount of Olives. And he's going to walk right into the eastern gate, through the eastern gate, into the city of Jerusalem. And his bride, that's the church, will be following right behind him in resurrected bodies. And we're going to have a big party. Why not? If you got a marriage, you got to have a party, a banquet, a ceremony. Jesus said many are going to come from east and west. And at this juncture, the Jewish people, the dispersed of Israel, those who have gone through the great tribulation, who have come to faith in Messiah, are going to come streaming back to Jerusalem to be part of this great wedding feast, this big banquet that Jesus is going to have in Jerusalem. But notice he says, for the unbelieving Jews, it says, but the sons of the kingdom, the ones that are going down the broad way, trusting in their mitzvahs. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus said, unless you believe that I am he, you will die in your sin. And so the nation of Israel, because of their unbelief, will not enter into God's kingdom. They'll not enter into heaven. They will indeed be cast into outer darkness. And some can say, those are awful strong words, weeping, gnashing of teeth. It's the truth. This comes from the loving Jesus' lips. He spoke more about judgment than anybody else. It's part of the Word of God. If you turn your back on God, you're choosing your own destination. Why would anybody want to do that? Sons of the kingdom, cast into outer darkness, there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go your way, as you have believed, so let it be done for you. Well, that takes us to verse 13. And his servant was healed the same hour. I believe I'm going to leave it off right there. What's the lesson we've learned for today? Well, sir, the credentials of Jesus are something wonderful. It's an awful thing to be sick. It's a worse thing to be terminally ill, painfully. I've known a lot of people who have died this way. And when there's hope that Jesus can heal you, how wonderful that is. And how wonderful that he started healing the lepers first, the worst of the worst. This is amazing. As I said before, the only people who were sick in the nation of Israel by the time Jesus went to the cross were the Pharisees and Sadducees. They didn't see their need. You say you see, you're blind still. How blessed is a man who sees his need. How many people am I talking to right now that are at the end of the rope and they're having trouble tying a knot? There's hope. This is a great message of God's word, but it's not found in the world system. Jesus didn't talk about politics in the Sermon on the Mount. They hated him for that. They were looking for a great deliverer to cast out Rome. But no, he said, your real need is you've got spiritual leprosy. You need to be healed. You need to be free like the bird that they let loose, the blood-stained bird, to always remember. You were not redeemed with silver and gold from your futile lifestyle, but by the precious blood of Christ. How wonderful. He died. He became a leper for us. when he hung on that cross for 6 hours, God the Father could not look on his own son. The sins of the world were placed upon him. He bore our sin. He became a leprous man for us for 6 hours so that we could be free, so that we could be healed, so that we could have a loving relationship with God, that he could heal the brokenhearted, bring us back together again, and bring our families together again. The peace that Jesus brings, he brings to the individual that believes in him. And those who will not believe in him will never experience peace. Not the peace of God that passes all understanding. They'll never experience that. And that is the saddest thing I could possibly say. If you're here listening to what I'm saying today, flee to Jesus. You have hope. He loves you. He will receive you. He will accept you. Come unto me, he said. Come unto me. All you that are weary and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. How wonderful. I want to thank you for joining us today, and may the Lord bless you until next time.